The learning objectives of this chapter are to understand the role of a competent person, to understand the role of a responsible officer, and to recognise how the responsible officer will apply the findings of the risk assessment for entry into a dangerous, enclosed or confined space. A competent person is a person capable of making an informal risk assessment. In the case of a proposed entry into an enclosed or confined space, this will primarily focus on the atmosphere within the space, but will also include a number of related factors, all of which the competent person must properly evaluate. The competent person should have sufficient theoretical knowledge and practical understanding of the hazards that might be encountered in order to be able to assess their likelihood and potential impact, and to define the precautions that will be necessary. A responsible officer is a person appointed by the master or by the company to take charge of an operation, such as entry into a dangerous, enclosed or confined space. The responsible officer may be the same individual as the competent person, or may be another officer specifically appointed to the task. The competent person and the responsible officer will usually be drawn from ship's personnel, but may, under certain circumstances, be appointed from shore. Superintendents, safety inspectors, dockyard managers, and repair specialists may all assume such duties, and, in these cases, it is essential that all personnel involved are aware of the identity of the responsible officer in particular. It is for the responsible officer to decide the procedures to be followed before and during entry into an enclosed or confined space. He will use the findings of the risk assessment to help him in his decisions and planning. The exact procedures will depend on whether the assessment shows there is minimal risk to the life or health of a person entering the space then or at any time in the future. There is no immediate risk to health and life, but a risk could arise during the course of work in the space. Or, the risk to life or health is significant or immediate. Click on the risk situation for more information. Where the assessment shows that there is minimal risk to the life or health of a person entering the space, then routine safety and documentation procedures will be followed. Where the assessment shows that there is no immediate risk to health or life, but that a risk could arise during the course of the work in the space, further procedures and certain additional precautions that will continue to monitor and safeguard personnel will be put into effect. Where the risk to health or life is immediate or significant, more particular, highly controlled procedures will be implemented. Irrespective of the level of risk assessed, the responsible officer must be alert to any unexpected change in circumstances and be prepared to implement emergency procedures at any time. Small vessels, or those with small crew complements, may not have the resources to designate either the competent person or the responsible officer. In such cases, these positions will normally be filled from shore. In these circumstances, no entry into a potentially dangerous space should be made until a suitably qualified person is available to fill each role. The 12,573 gross registered tons US flag tanker William T. Steele was preparing to load a cargo of benzene at Guayanilla, Puerto Rico. Unfortunately, due to a planning oversight in the manifold rigging, the cargo was inadvertently loaded into the wrong tank, number 9 center, which had been reserved for a cargo of xylene. There was no chance of working with the wrong stowage, so the benzene was transferred out, and number 9 center was washed and ventilated. Two crewmen entered the forward end of No. 9 centre to insert an isolation blank in a flange in a pipeline, and the chief officer went to the after part of the tank to eject water from the sump area. The two crewmen working forward were unaware of the presence of the chief officer. When the flanges in the line were cracked, benzene began to leak out, and the fumes forced the two crewmen to leave the compartment without completing their task. Once on deck, one of the crewmen looked back down into the tank and saw the chief officer lying in the bottom. The alarm was raised, and the second officer and several other crewmen entered the space without breathing apparatus to rescue the chief officer. By this time, the master had arrived on deck, and he donned a breathing apparatus and followed the others into the tank. When he reached the second officer, some way down into the tank, he noticed that he was experiencing difficulty in breathing and attempted to share his air supply. As he tried to pass the mask over, both men fell the remaining distance to the bottom of the tank. Seeing this, the other crewmen immediately exited the tank. They survived, but all three officers died. The subsequent investigation by the U.S. National Transportation Safety Board concluded that both the chief officer and second officer died from prolonged exposure to the highly concentrated benzene vapors, and the master died from the same cause, but also possibly due to injuries sustained in the fall.